fooling one girl, she's only fooling tangerine.
Director of Public Programs and Community Engagement, as we bring you in with sounds of the 1940s, the World War II era of the big band swing music, because that's what our program is about tonight, Okinawa, the combat on the doorstep of Japan, which we'll get to in just a moment. But first, want to remind you to be here with us on Facebook a week from tonight, same time, because we'll bring you a special presentation featuring Ann Mosley, who is the curator of the Sangamon Experience at University of Illinois Springfield. She used to be with the Lincoln Heritage Museum in Lincoln, Illinois, until recently. That's where they have a special exhibit ongoing this year, celebrating the 100th anniversary of women's right to vote, with an exhibit called Defying the Odds, about the suffrage movement in Illinois. She'll be here next week to talk about that movement and what it led to in 1920, 100 years ago this month. And Illinois, of course, played an important role in that. But tonight, we're fast-forwarding a few more years to 1940s, during the heart of the Second World War. Last month, of course, you were here for the story of Iwo Jima. Tonight, we bring you the story of the Battle of Okinawa with our esteemed director of the Oral History Program, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Mark DePue.
Thank you, Joe. And thank you for checking in and for being with us tonight. Okinawa, combat on the doorstep of Japan. The last battle of World War II, and if you recall our conversation last time about Iwo Jima, this is a larger, longer, bloodier version of Iwo Jima. The intensity of the combat was every bit the same, but it involved lots more troops on both sides, and it lasted about 2.5 months. So let's go ahead and dive right into it and start with a little bit of background. As you recall from last time, about June or July of 1944, there was a high power meeting in Honolulu, of all places, that involved President Roosevelt, Admirals Nimitz and King, and General MacArthur, and they had quite a discussion about where to go to next. The decision was they made then finally to go to Iwo Jima, but to allow MacArthur to continue in advance on the Philippines as well. Well, a couple months later in September 1944, the Navy brass meets in San Francisco. So you've got Admirals Nimitz and King again, and they kind of hash things out. And once again, there's this disagreement. And the disagreement is centered on where to go to next as far as the Central Pacific is concerned. So King was all in favor of going all the way to Formosa, thought that would be the logical place to go. Nimitz, remembering the conversation, the agreements they had before, was in favor of Iwo Jima. And it's tough to see, but Iwo Jima is right here, this little star out in the middle of nowhere. And of course, they had already decided that Iwo Jima is going to be next. That starts in March. And then where to go to after Iwo Jima? If not Formosa, the next step was going to be somewhere in the Ryukyu Islands, and the logical place was Okinawa. So here's Okinawa, the mainland, the surrounding islands, which are going to be a part of it. I didn't touch it. It's not supposed to do that. Oh, well. Anyway, that was the decision that was finally made, and they codenamed it Operation Iceberg. Don't ask me how they come up with these names. They're always colorful. So a little bit about Okinawa itself. It's 60 miles long and anywhere from 2 to 18 miles wide. It's 485 square miles. So remember how tiny Iwo Jima was. This is a much, much larger island. It's part of the Ryukyu chain of islands. It's mountainous terrain in the northern parts, and it's central area, and you can kind of see that here. The landing beaches are going to be right in this vicinity right here. And it's lowland plains, lots of fields, and then the southern part of the island, although it's hard to tell, lots of more rolling terrain. the top half of the island is cut off here. It's a little bit more mountainous. The population of Okinawa was about 500,000. Most of them lived in the southern portion of the island, or in that central area that I just pointed out. The southern third, though, you can take a look at it. It doesn't look like it's nice rolling terrain, does it? It's steep, natural escarpments, ravines, terraces, ridges, and lots of natural caves. Primarily, these are coral formations over the eons that had developed. In other words, it's ideal terrain for the enemy to defend. Very good terrain for that. There is one major city, and you can see on the map there, it's Naha and Shuri. And if I can find that quickly here, here is Naha, and here is Shuri, the ancient capital of Okinawa, and there's an ancient cathedral or castle there as well, which is going to end up being the headquarters for the Japanese for the entire campaign. As I mentioned, the population is, it's not Japanese. They're a mixture of Malay, Chinese, Philippine. They're a little bit smaller than the Japanese. The Japanese actually took control of the island in 1879. It was one of their first conquests. And the Japanese looked down on the Okinawans, didn't think too much of them. And of course, the Okinawans were happy to reciprocate in their feelings about the Japanese in many respects. And I wanted to play then here this is a picture of a typical village, and you can see it's very much agricultural. And I wanted to play this quote from Ernie Pyle. And for those of you who remember Ernie Pyle, he spent most of the war with the infantry in Italy. He was beloved by all of the GIs. They absolutely adored him. He ended the war here in Okinawa.
I'll try and describe to you what this island looks like. Actually, it doesn't look a great deal different from most of America. In fact, it looks more like America than anything the Marines have seen for the last 3 years. The climate is temperate rather than tropical, and so is the vegetation. The country rose gradually from the sea, and it was formed into small fields. It didn't look at all unlike Indiana in late summer when things have started to turn dry and brown, except that the fields were much smaller. As you get inland, the country becomes rougher. In the hills, there is less cultivation and more trees. It is really a pretty country.
There you go. That's Ernie Pyle's description of it. And you'll hear that again, a description that feels much more temperate and more like at home. A little bit about the Japanese command then. The 32nd Army is stationed in Okinawa. It had been there for quite a while, upwards of 9 months, when the commander, Lieutenant General Yoshijima, showed up and took control of the island's forces. Approximately 100,000 troops. And it's a mixture of frontline units. There's three divisions that are, excuse me, there's the 62nd Division, there's the 24th Division, which is the 62nd is a very light division. It was designed to fight in China and basically guerrilla warfare. The 24th was a much heavier division. It was designed to fight against the Russians. So they had what Americans would consider the equivalent of lots of artillery, fire support of various types, the logistical chain that you would need to have a heavier combat operation, and some auxiliary units as well. There was also about 20,000 Okinawans, and some of them were decent troops, but a lot of them had just been conscripted right before this campaign is actually going to start. So they are not reliable, they are not your frontline troops, and you're going to see them sacrificed on a couple occasions here as we move forward. Okay, the commander is Lieutenant General Yoshijima, an interesting person in his own right. He was embodiment of the samurai spirit. He embraced that whole tradition of being the samurai warfare. Stoic and Spartan in his traditions, an infantryman a former combatant of the Japanese Military Academy. And early on, he had expressed his disagreement with the decision to attack Pearl Harbor, thought it was a bad idea, had that respect for the American military force and certainly their potential. He's described as ramrod strength, unshakable self-control, very well respected and admired by his soldiers across the line. And he takes command of the 32nd Army in August of 1944. And it's really about that time forward that we see them doing some serious preparations because they figured that was one of the Americans' next step. The other commander here who I'm featuring is Lieutenant General Isamu Cho. And Cho is the chief of staff for the 32nd Army. He is a very different kind of a person. He's a hothead, would be the best way to describe him, very quick temper. And here's one of the fascinating parts to me. He was anti-democratic, anti-capitalistic, was in favor of a military dictatorship to the point where in 1931, he had participated in a coup to overthrow the prime minister. The coup failed. So what happens in an American who were to do something like that? And it would be bad news. Well, it was bad news for Cho as well. They sent him up to a command in Manchuria. He stays in the army. That's what happened, people, that time. That tells you a lot about the nature of Japanese government and the military at that time, that he can survive and still be part of the system to a certain extent. In fact, he has a role to play in the Mukden incident and a couple of the incidents that lead to the Japanese getting involved with major combat operations in first Manchuria and then in China. He's right in the midst of this. They're instigating these things that draw Japan into these major wars. So that's who he is. He also is something of a sophisticated. He likes to have nice things around him to include, here's a quote that I found, might be found unrivaled meals, the best Scotch whiskey, the finest sake, and the prettiest women. So that tells you a little bit about who Cho is. Okay, a little bit more then about the Japanese defenses. IGHQ, that's Imperial Government Headquarters. Excuse me, Imperial General Headquarters in Tokyo. Their concept was that there was two major airstrips there, a couple minor ones as well. And the main job of the 32nd Army, as far as the headquarters was concerned, was to guard those airstrips, to keep them operational, to maintain them, to continue to upgrade them. And that is not at all what the Japanese who were there, the commanders who were there, thought should happen. And here's the third character that's very important to this whole discussion, and it's Colonel Hiromichi Yahara. He is the plans officer, the chief of planning for the 32nd Army. And you need to understand something about the nature of command in the Japanese Army at this time. They somewhat modeled their command structure after the Germans. And if you know something about the German Army, a chief of staff and the staff in general had a lot to do with any kind of operational decisions. And that was maybe even more so for the Japanese. Certainly it was for the 32nd Army. So you have Yusajima, who is very much the man who stands in the background and lets Cho and Yahara kind of argue things back and forth, because those two gentlemen, Cho and Yahara, had dramatically different visions for how to defend the island. And eventually it's Yahara who's he's the alter ego, he's the opposite of Cho in terms of personality. Quiet, stoic, intense, and believing strongly in his positions. And his idea was to allow the Americans to land relatively unopposed, don't get bogged down in defending the airstrips, but wait for them to come to you. Now, this is going to sound pretty similar to Iwo Jima and Kuribayashi's view of how Iwo Jima should be defended. Very similar, I think, in a lot of respects. So once they land, then dogged resistance to defend the southern third of the island. Minimal defense for the rest of the island itself. and not much in the central area, the lowlands area. That's where the Okinawan troops often would be there to resist. The other part of this equation is kamikaze attacks. Now, you might recall that there was a little bit of the use of kamikazes both in the Philippines but in the end in Iwo Jima, but we're going to get into this is going to be ramped up to the maximum level here at Okinawa. The idea was that kamikaze aircraft and suicide boats and bombs that they could drop from aircraft that were pilotless would destroy the American fleet as much as possible, to the point where the American fleet would have to leave and isolate the American troops on land. And then the Japanese could go on the offensive. That was the notion. I'm not sure that Yahara believed that was going to be successful, but he was totally committed and was able to convince Yoshijima and others that this is the approach that we need to take. This is going to be a battle of attrition, and just like Iwo Jima, we're going to fight to the last man and cause the enemy as much bloodshed and destruction as possible. Here is the 32nd Army slogan then. One plane for one warship, one boat for one ship, one man for 10 of the enemy, or one tank. And that was their idea, to bloody the American force both at sea and on land to the point where the American public and the high command in the United States would say, this is too much, it's not worth it, let's sit down on the negotiating table and forget about this concept of an unconditional surrender. That was the goal, seeking negotiated peace. Okay. We need to take a closer look at then of the Japanese fortifications, and I thought these diagrams kind of illustrated it fairly well. The terrain in the southern third of Okinawa was conducive to lots of tunnels, lots of caves. In fact, there were lots of natural caves that people could use in the first place. And the Japanese had months and months to work on developing their fortifications. They found that the coral might be a few feet deep, and you mix the coral with water, and it set up pretty nicely, almost like cement. They also had some cement that was brought in. They were scarce on logistics, and one of the things they were concerned about was having enough timber to shore up their tunnel system. Fortunately, the northern half of the island was filled with forest, so all they had to do was figure out how to get those trees that they could fell themselves down to the southern part of the island and fortify there. Now, one picture here is a bit deceiving. You can see clearly these caves that had been dug into the side of a hill. That would not be the case when the Americans first got there. I'm sure that the Americans burned this off. This is afterwards. They would have been very well hidden and incredibly hard to find. You can see how deep they might go. 35 feet? Oh my gosh. That's deep. They would dig very deep. The goal was to have fortifications to the point where it was impervious to enemy shelling, to bombardment of any type, whether it be naval bombardment, heavy and medium bombers, or fighter aircraft coming in on this. And that's what they did. They had 9 months. They built this very intricate system. And you can see in both of these how small the aperture is that they want to expose to the enemy. Impossible to find in the first place, and very difficult to destroy once you do locate it. The problem is this kind of a position very much limits the fire that the Japanese can have, limits their fields of fire going back and forth. They would solve that problem to a certain extent by having a huge number of these bunkers and positions that could mutually support each other as the Americans were advancing on it. So I want to mention one other thing. I mentioned Shuri Castle, which is where the headquarters for the Japanese were. That was dug anywhere from 50 to 160 feet deep. They were determined nothing was going to be able to get to them. An incredible lattice of tunnels and connecting positions that could provide support for over 1,000 headquarters troops. in everything and anything you could possibly imagine, and well-stocked and provisioned, to include General Cho's luxury items, I might add. And there were even 30 young women there, 12 Japanese and 18 Okinawa women who were helping with clerical duties and other things. You can imagine what other things might be. Okay. So that's the Japanese spending months preparing for the Americans. So let's take a look at the Allied command. Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz and the operational commander on the ground, or in the sea, I should say, is Admiral Raymond Spruance, commander of the 5th Fleet. You can see his picture over on the right. An interesting fellow in his own right. He was something of a stoic himself, very quiet, and he believed in pushing power down to giving as much latitude as possible to his subordinates. And he was the hero of Midway. He was the hero of the Philippine Sea. So people like FDR were willing to tolerate his idiosyncrasies, to include things like his flagship was the USS Indianapolis. You might remember that. That's the ship that both carried the atomic bomb to Tinian Island and was sunk afterwards, after it had done so. Anyway, Spruance would walk up and down the deck of the Indianapolis in his shorts, no shirt, white socks and black shoes, thinking 3 or 4 hours at a time, just kind of thinking and pondering on things. That tells you a little bit about the personality of Spruance. Admiral Richmond Turner, a 1908 graduate of West Point, 1908 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy. He would skewer me if he heard me say that mistake, I imagine. He was the brains behind the Navy and the Marines amphibious training and amphibious operations. He was one of the key people that developed the notion of amphibious landings very early in the war. And so he's going to have the responsibility of being in charge of all amphibious forces, to include, you can see at the bottom there, the 3rd Amphibious Corps, 3 Marine divisions. Not sure how Marines feel about having a Navy officer command them, but nonetheless, that's the way the command structure worked. Lieutenant General Simon Buckner, Jr. That name should ring a bell if you are a Civil War buff, because his father was the one who surrendered to General Grant at Fort Donelson early in the war. So he's got this great pedigree. He's a 1908 West Point graduate, and he becomes an aviator in 1917. Spends most of his early career at military schools, but by the time you get close to the war, he's had a series of successful commands. So he's going to be the 10th Army commander. And you can see in that case, you've got the 10th Army with the 24th Corps is the heart of that, the 7th, the 27th, 77th, and 96th Division, 4 U.S. Army divisions. So here's the difference between Iwo Jima and Okinawa. Not just the number of units, but you've got a sizable Army contingent there. And the 3rd Amphibious Corps with these 3 Marine divisions, with the 1st and the 6th playing the largest role for that. So General Hodge is the other general. He is in command of the 24th Corps, those 4 divisions. But it's going to be Buckner who's making most of the key decisions. And like Iwo Jima, once you get into the combat, it's not a whole lot of maneuvering that you've got going back and forth. It's fighting at the squad and platoon and company level. And by the time that company is in combat for a day or two, it's the size of a squad or a platoon. That's the way it's going to work. A little bit more about the naval forces. Consider these numbers. The 5th Fleet, this is Spruance's fleet, 17 fleet carriers. By this time, the Japanese really aren't much of a naval threat at all. 9 light carriers, 13 battleships, including the USS Nevada, we'll hear about in a little bit, 18 heavy cruisers, including Spruance's flagship, the Indianapolis, 23 light cruisers, scores of destroyers, and then all the other ships that it takes to support this, to include the landing craft, oilers, tankers, supply ships, everything. So I think on the landing day itself, there were something like 1,300 ships off the coastline of Okinawa. Now, so there's a picture of this vast armada that Spruance commands, and it's not just all of that. He also has operational command of Task Force 57, a British task force, whose main mission, as I understand it, was primarily to kind of isolate and concentrate on Formosa at the time. So they have complete command of the sea, and they probably thought at the time complete command of the air, except for kamikazes, which we're going to touch on here in a little bit. L-Day. So why isn't it D-Day? Why didn't they use D-Day? Because in actuality, to avoid confusion, Iwo Jima was still wrapping up at the time Okinawa was being launched. So to avoid confusion, they called D-Day, in this case, L-Day, or Landing Day. The pre-invasion preparation included 6 days of naval bombardment. Now, before this time, heavy bombers and medium bombers had been bombarding the island for months on hand. But now you've got every big gun in the Navy blasting away at Okinawa, hoping and thinking that they can destroy much of the defensive works for 6 days, much longer than Iwo Jima, because if you recall, that was one of the complaints the Marines had about Iwo Jima, that they hadn't received the amount of support from the naval gunfire that they thought was necessary. They also were going to be landing on Hagushi Beach. I always have to check the pronunciations of these. Here's Hagushi Beach, right in here. And there's going to be a feint by the 2nd Marine Division down here in Minnetonka. This particular area right here is not very conducive to a landing at all. But the feint was fairly effective. It held some of the Japanese forces in position in the south. The landing itself, then, at 0450 hours, the bombardment begins, the main bombardment in direct preparation for the landing itself. It goes on for a while, then that stops, then you have naval air, lots of fighter bombers hitting the defenses as much as they possibly could. And of course, the biggest problem was locating them in the first place, and the second biggest problem was how do you root something out that's buried 30 to 50 feet under the ground. And then at H hour, at 8:30 hours, the whole force goes in. So here's the landing beach itself. And if you look at this, on the left, you have the 6th Marine and the 1st Marine. The 6th Marine's main job was to get Yantan Airfield and then drive in east. To the south, you have the Army, two divisions online. You've got the 7th Infantry Division and the 96th. And it's the 7th Infantry that has to take this other major airfield, Kadena. Remember, brass in Tokyo thought that that's what they should be defending, these two airfields. That's not the way it worked. That wasn't the decisions that were made in Okinawa itself. So that's the way things look. It went very well. There was minimal resistance. The Okinawans that were defending some of these areas weren't willing to put up a rugged defense. They weren't necessarily as convinced to die for the Emperor of Japan as a Japanese soldier would be. And they actually achieved their objective very early in the day, and I got to their L plus 3 objectives, what they thought they would achieve 3 days into this exercise. And by the end of L Day, the Americans had lost 28 killed, 27 missing, and 104 wounded. Pretty light. We would consider that almost unacceptable today, but for what they were experiencing beforehand, that's very light. Okay. Next, then, let's concentrate just a little bit on northern Okinawa, and it's the 6th Marine that had been the leftmost division on the beach, drives north, meaning minimal resistance. So again, here are the two airfields. Two-thirds of the island is north of that. And in this two-thirds area, there's about 3,000 troops, something in that neighborhood. And south of there, that's well over 90,000. So that gives you an idea of the decisions that had been made prior to this. By April 8th, they have reached the peninsula right here, the Mutobu Peninsula. This Yaitake is the major peak there, and that's the one location that the Japanese put up fierce resistance in the northern two-thirds. About 2,000 of their troops were actually on the Mutobu Peninsula right here. They also had some major forces on Ishima, this tiny little island we're going to focus on next. Now, during this operation, as the Marines are moving north, on April 12th, FDR dies. And it's curious to think about the mindset of both the Japanese and the Germans, who elevated their top leaders to, you know, mythic proportions. They were some kind of god. In terms of the Japanese, that was definitely the case for the emperor. And so they thought there would be a huge blow to American morale when FDR dies. It was certainly difficult for the GIs and the Marines because, honestly, they'd known no other president. But it just wasn't in the makeup for the Americans. April 17th, they captured Mount Yataki, and they discovered this interesting message that the commander had left for him before, I believe, he commits suicide deep within Mount Yataki. "We take it as great honor to speak to you for the first time. We are awfully sorry to learn from the UP Telegraph that the life of President Roosevelt has suddenly come to an end. Men of the 6th Marine Division, we express our hearty regret with you all over the death of the late president. What do you think was the true cause of the late president's death? A miserable defeat experienced by the U.S. forces in the sea around the island of Okinawa. We do not think the majority of you have exact knowledge of the present operations being carried out by the U.S. forces. An exceedingly great number of picked aircraft carriers, battleship, cruisers, and destroyers hold on her course to and near the Sea of Okinawa in order to protect you and carry out operations in concert with you. 90% of them have already been sunk and destroyed by the Japanese special fighting bodies, sea and air. A grand USC bottom fleet numbering 500 has been brought into existence around this little island." That was the message that they read when they got to this headquarters position. Well, it's a bit of an exaggeration, isn't it? But I wanted to play a quote that I got from one of the interviews I did a few years back with Ralph Contreras, a Marine in the 6th Marine Division.
Well, that I was really scared there and gone because I knew I had to pass that area where that machine gun was. Well, anyway, I went back up there and dumped the stuff out and went back and nothing happened. So I get back to the dump and I'm showing the guys where the bullets were in the trailer. The trailer was full of bullet holes there's the end of the trailer and I'm right here. The bullets are lodged right in here where they went through the back, but then they stopped there. I was showing the guys. Then all of a sudden, I start shaking the heck. Then I start crying. So they grabbed me and put me on a stretcher. And I remember them loading me on an ambulance. They put me in an ambulance. And I remember I was passing in and I was coming to and I could see people moving around and hearing people talking and stuff like that. Then all of a sudden, I just passed out. So then, I don't know how long it was afterwards, I woke up and I see this woman walking down there and I said, "Oh, Jesus, I'm in heaven and there's an angel." And pretty soon the doctor come over and he says, "You're all right, son, you're all right." He said, you're 10 miles behind the line. You're in an Army hospital." And that's an Army nurse, sir. Said, "You're all right." So that made me feel better. But anyway, I that's what I had. I cracked up. I had a combat fatigue, we called it. And so they kept me there for a couple weeks, and then they sent me back to the front lines, back to where I was again.
I like that quote for a couple reasons. One, Ralph's honesty to tell me that story in the first place. Most people, I don't think, would be willing to admit that they had a major case of combat fatigue like he described. But it was hardly unusual for this campaign. There were thousands who had that same problem, as there were at Iwo Jima as well, and it had everything to do with the intensity of the combat and the length. And this is going to be campaigns that's going on for months on Okinawa itself. And I'm sure he looked at those bullet holes in the back of his Jeep trailer and thought, oh my gosh, how close did that come for me being killed? The other thing that that struck me is, what happens after he recovers? He's sent back to the front lines with the 6th Marines and fought with them for the rest of the campaign. Ishima, that little island that was off the west coast of Okinawa, is the mission for the 77th Division to take, and you can see that the island has a major airstrip there as well. It's a 6-day fight. Initial landings was relatively unopposed, but by the time they got to the high ground, 185 meters high, and the town of E-Town, they called it, and right in the center of Bloody Ridge, that's where the resistance was the strongest. And once again, this is the division that Ernie Pyle has hooked up with. He's following along with them. And we've got another quote that Ernie Pyle had, his reflections while this fight is going on.
Sometimes I get so mad and despairing, I can hardly keep from crying. I worry so much about what might happen to me. I've even gotten to brooding about it and sometimes can't sleep. I become so revolted, so nauseated by the sight of swell kids having their heads blown off. I'd lost track of the whole point of the war. I'd reached a point where I felt that no ideal was worth the death of one more man.
As many of you know, just a few days later, Ernie Pyle is killed by a Japanese sniper. So the buddy of every GI and Marine in the American forces dies near the very end of the war. Okay. Very much a part of the campaign in Okinawa, much more so than Iwo Jima or the Philippines, were the kamikaze attacks, kamikaze or divine wind. They were first used there in the Philippines just a few months before. There's about 3,000 aircraft that the Japanese have available to do this. And the notion was that you had your less experienced, your newest pilots, the young kids who volunteer. And most of them did willingly volunteer to do this. Most of those aircraft were in mainland Japan itself, but a sizable number were coming from Formosa as well. The initial times that the kamikazes were used, and this isn't hard to understand, the reports that the returning pilots who had accompanied them, the mainline pilots who always were escorts for these flights, coming back, would have greatly exaggerated numbers of the enemy ships that were hit and or sunk, which was just enough for the Japanese to double down and triple down on the use of kamikazes. April 6th was the first date that they were used, and they attacked the Fifth Fleet. And the way it worked, the Americans were expecting this, so around the northern part of the island especially, pushing out many, many miles would be a picket line of American destroyers. So as the kamikazes were attacking the American fleet, the first thing they would encounter is these tin cans, very thin armored American destroyers, and most of the Japanese kamikaze pilots were enticed to be attacking the destroyers instead of going after the real targets, which were the big aircraft carriers much closer to Okinawa itself. So the destroyers formed the picket line. They're the first ones hit. And that first attack, two destroyers are sunk, nine more are damaged, two ammunition ships are sunk. And this is a big blow because those two ammunition ships are needed to resupply the forces on land. And that's going to be a bit of a hindrance in the future. So a total of six ships and sunk and 21 damaged. The Japanese lose 135 planes, you know, most of them by design, the kamikazes, but a few of their conventional aircraft as well. What do they report? That 30 American ships are sunk and 20 more are burning. So again, greatly inflated numbers that you've got. This is the first time, but there are nine more major kamikaze raids over the next couple months. And a few of those early on were very effective, very dangerous. By the time you get to May, late May and early June, the effectiveness has really petered out. But imagine the strain on American sailors, especially those who are on these destroyers in the picket line, when wave after wave of kamikazes are coming with your number, determined to kill you. That's got to wear on people too. Overall, it was a deadly toll, 206 ships sunk and 225 damaged. But nothing like what the Japanese were hoping for or were reporting, and not to anywhere close to the point where the American fleet would abandon the Americans on shore. They felt somewhat like sitting ducks because they had to stay in Okinawa waters, but they were determined to do that anyway. I do have a quote from Charles Sahe, who served on the USS Nevada. You're going to hear him pronounce it a little bit differently. He insists that's the way it's pronounced, is Nevada. He was on the Nevada at Pearl Harbor the day of the Pearl Harbor attack. He was about the youngest man in the crew at the time. He stayed with the ship as it got refurbished in Bremerton, Washington, then went to the Alaska area. Then it went through the Panama Canal and went over to support the landings at Utah Beach and in southern France, then came back to the Pacific and was at Iwo Jima, and now at Okinawa. And at Okinawa now they're attacked once again by Japanese kamikazes.
March 27, at dawn's early light. It was about 6:32 then. See, that's the best time to attack is in the morning. That morning, there were three planes coming, approaching the Nevada. Two on the port side where I was, and one on the starboard side, heading for the bow straight. They wanted to get the controlling center. Knock that out, they can do it. So that plane was headed for the navigation bridge, where the cat, you know. Now, see, I'm on the 20 millimeter. This one came in almost to the bow. My friend George Peters, a Marine, he's on the bow. He couldn't be anywhere else. Right a smack in the bow in front of the anchor apparatus. I mean, that guy was, and that sucker was coming right through his nose. He had 20 millimeter, and he clipped off part of the wing. I didn't know what this was going on because I was on the other side. We had our own problem. That wing made them turn a little bit this way, and he's going out to sea. But that pilot, he managed somehow to turn it around, and he came back to the ship. So he hit the back end number three turret, right smack into the turret, blew up.
Charles is still alive. He's living in Mankato, Minnesota. He's now 97 years old, and he averages about one letter every 2 weeks that he sends to me and gives me more reports of different aspects of his service during World War II. He's an amazing gentleman. Okay, more of the naval campaign. Battleship Yamato and the USS Bunker Hill, something of on either side. The battleship Yamato, you can see this picture here, is the largest ship in the world at the time. It has 18.1-inch guns, nine of them. Now, as a matter of scale, 18.1-inch, how big is that? The largest battleship at the time for the United States was the Iowa-class battleship that had 16-inch guns. So these things were a mammoth, and they could stand off. It was just a surface ship to a surface ship. They could blow us out of the water. The Japanese decide to send the Yamato on a suicide mission. Their objective is to reach that harbor area just off the beaches in Okinawa, to beach it right on the shore, just ram it right into the shore, and then sit there and with those main guns blast away at any American vessel that got close enough to do that. Now, the Americans knew about this long out. Oh, by the way, they only had enough fuel to get to Okinawa. The intention was this was a suicide mission for the crew of the Yamato and for the five or six other ships that were accompanying them. April 5th, they depart Japan. 2 days later, the U.S. Naval Air Forces intercept them. And it's primarily U.S. Naval Air, both torpedo bombers and dive bombers. And by the time it's done, let me see if I can find some numbers here. The ship takes 7 torpedo hits and 12 bomb hits, the Yamato does. It has 3 admirals on board, all determined to commit suicide as well, to go down with the ship. In fact, the senior admiral was so determined that he was lashed to a beam. Another admiral locked himself in his cabin and refused to come out as the ship was sinking. So that is the demise of the USS Yamato. And it gives you an idea of the desperation of the Japanese at that time. On the flip side, a little bit later than that, a month later, May 11th, in one of these series of kamikaze attacks, the Japanese do get to the USS Bunker Hill, one of the major fleet carriers. And this Ensign Yoshi Ogawa, who you can see pictured here, is the one who's credited for the hit that really is going to damage and take the Bunker Hill out of the fight. And you land right in the midship close to the castle area, and there's nothing you can do with that carrier except take it back to Bremerton and go through months and months of major repairs. So they are able to knock out the Bunker Hill with 2 kamikaze hits. Okay, so at this time we still have the American forces on Okinawa. So now it's time to turn our attention to that bottom one-third of the island. By L plus 2, the second day, they've already divided the island in half. The Marines and the 7th had both gotten over to the eastern side of the island. And you can see it's only a few miles wide at this area in the first place as well. And the Army forces, the 7th and the 96th now, are going to take a hard right turn, with the 7th going down the eastern side of the island and the 96th Division going down the western side of the island. They are facing the 62nd Japanese Division. That is the light division, the less reliable, the less robust of the two Japanese divisions. And it's not too long. It's April 4th now. They're beginning to hit some much tougher resistance of the Japanese. All these defensive positions that we've been illustrating before is what they're running against. The 96th, I've got a better map here. The 96th runs into Kakuza Ridge. You can see, where'd it go? Right here. So we got the 7th and the 96th. So the 96th really bloodies itself in Kakuza, attack after attack, going after that particular position. And by the 19th, the Americans had worked their way down to the Machinato line. And you can see that red band that extends across the island. That's the major line of defense, that first line of defense for the Japanese. And finally, after determined resistance for several days, the Japanese decide to abandon that line and move south. And they didn't move that far south, because here now is this positions, the new positions that you can see, that red line that I put in there. And it's going to be along the Uroso Mura Escarpment, Coetzee Ridge, the Asa River is the left boundary of it. That's where this new position is going to be. And it's in this area now, the next month, that combat is especially going to be brutal. And it's about this time, after the two army divisions have really been in some tough combat and down considerably in their infantry strength especially, General Buckner decides to make some decisions. And the 27th Division now, and National Guard Division, is going to replace the 6th Marines in the north. 6th Marines are going to be coming to the south. The 77th Division replaces the 96th on the left side of the island. And the 1st and the 6th Marine now are both going to be in combat moving south with the 7th Infantry Division on the east. Okay. Now, here a little personal touch, because it's hard to imagine the scale of this until you can begin to personalize it in a certain way, and that's what I wanted to do here, especially in the case of Private Charles Leo Rabine. And I got information about him from one of our colleagues here who works in the theater department, Dale Jensen. This is his uncle. And Leo, that's what he went by, had sent a V-mail, those tiny little messages that the military was using, where you photocopy it, you put it on a reel of tape, you throw it in a duffel bag, and you fly it back home, rather than taking all the weight that a piece of letter, a mail, would actually do. So he V-mails his sister, and here's the message that he writes to his sister. Dear Pauline, we'll drop you a few lines to let you know I am fine and hope you are the same. Am now in a combat zone in the island of Okinawa. This is a pretty island. They raise mostly vegetables, so we get plenty of them to eat. I think he's a farm kid. I hope you had a good time Easter. I hadn't mentioned, April 1st, L Day, was Easter. That was Easter Sunday, the day this all began. I hope you had a good time Easter. It was just another day for us, only we did have an Easter sermon. And then he goes on a little bit farther in this message. Well, there isn't much more to write about, so we'll close, hoping to hear from you soon. We'll write when I have time. Lots of love, Leo. And then he throws in this interesting little P.S. P.S. are sleeping in foxholes. Well, yes, he absolutely was sleeping in foxholes, because on the 1st, he was part of that landing force with the 7th Infantry Division that seized that airstrip and then continued to move eastward. By the 4th, the 77th is attacking south. And unfortunately, on the 19th is when they got the Machinato line. That was the major line of defense. And 2 days later, he died. He was killed in combat. And his body was never found. He was missing in action, crushing his whole family, as you might imagine. There's a picture of the young man in all of his youth. So that's the toll that's being borne, not by just Leo Rabine, but by so many thousands of others who are suffering casualties during this time. The one that we know so much about is Denman Doss, because there was a movie that came out recently called Hacksaw Ridge just a few years ago, commemorating his life. He was a Seventh-day Adventist, a conscientious objector, who became a combat medic. And he took an awful lot of grief in training because he refused to even carry a weapon. But by the time they got to combat in Okinawa, he had earned his stripes and he was respected by the troops. On April 29th, he's in an action. And the action that he's written up for in his Medal of Honor citation includes actions on April 29th, May 2nd, May 5th, May 21st. But it's what happened on April 29th at this ridge, Yuraso Mura Ridge, right in the middle of the island that he is so well known for. And take a look at this ridge right here. As far as I know, this is a picture of where he was handing down soldiers, because here's the cargo net. But I need to read you the first portion of his citation. Near Yuraso Mura, Okinawa, PFC Doss was a company A man when the 1st Battalion assaulted a jagged escarpment 400 feet high. As our troops gained the summit, a heavy concentration of artillery, mortar, and machine gun fire crashed into them, inflicting approximately 75 casualties and driving the others back. Private First Class Doss refused to seek cover and remained in the fire-swept area with the many stricken, carrying them one by one to the edge of the escarpment and there lowering them in a rope-supported litter down the face of a cliff to friendly hands. Now, the question I have, it says 400 feet in the write-up in the Medal of Honor citation. I think that might be the actual elevation where this occurred, but still, it's a remarkable feat. And this is just one of several incidents. Each one of them could have earned him the Medal of Honor on its own. He was awarded the Medal of Honor and then spent the rest of his life avoiding the limelight. He wanted nothing to do with the attention. And so it's only after his death that Hollywood was able to make a movie about his life. And that was Mel Gibson who did that. So again, here's a picture of the intensity of the combat to get a feel of it. And it's all small unit actions. In fact, a little bit more about the evolving U.S. tactics of how to defeat these bunker systems that the Japanese had so elaborately dug and prepared. And one other quote here from Gunnery Sergeant Mike Gorakoff. This is one that our actors brought to life for me, about the attacks on Sugarloaf Hill.
We made 11 thrusts at that hill and fell back each time with most of our boys dead or missing. It wasn't uncommon to see a PFC commanding the platoon as it fell back from a push up the hill. It seemed that the lieutenants fell first, then the sergeants.
Again, the intensity of the combat, the number of casualties, the chain of command keep working its way down until you have a PFC in charge of the remnants of the platoon to begin with. Very high casualties. But over time, the Americans started to evolve new tactics that were going to be much more effective. And it was important for them to have these flamethrowers, and especially these flamethrower tanks, and to work in conjunction with dismounted infantry and tanks moving forward. So here's the blowtorch and corkscrew tactics that they eventually developed. You would use everything you had in the arsenal: machine guns, mortars, heavy artillery, naval gunfire, aircraft, to go after what you thought might be the openings of some of these bunkers. And in the process, you're driving the Japanese deep inside the bunkers, or if not killing them outright, and allowing you now to approach the opening of the bunker with the tanks, with flamethrowers, with the infantry, until the infantry could get close enough and stand adjacent, straddling the openings and kind of fire into the portholes. Or, maybe better yet, a satchel charge thrown in the opening and sealing whoever's inside. In most cases, they didn't seal them because there are so many other entrances and exits that they could escape out the back side of it. But in many, many cases, there were probably thousands of Japanese that were buried permanently in their tombs. So that was the nature of the infantry, the tactics that had developed. And I think the picture is pretty illustrative of the nature of those.
We made 11 thrusts.
The Japanese, by the time they get to close to the Naha Shuri line, their main line of defense, before they actually got there, were having a debate of their own. General Cho, remember the hothead, the one who thought the military dictatorship would be wonderful, a real samurai in his spirit, wanted to have a massive counterattack. And the objectives of the counterattack was to The 24th would attack, the 24th was the heavy division they had. So first you had the 44th separate brigade kind of open a hole in the middle of the American lines for the 24th to advance through the lines, take a hard left, get all the way to the west coast of the island, and encircle the 1st Marine Division where they could be destroyed in detail. That was one of the plans. Meanwhile, they had two amphibious forces, both on the east and the west side of the island, that would go far to the rear of the American forces to really disrupt as much as possible. And part of the notions for this, I'm sure Cho believed this in his heart, that Japanese were absolutely superior to Americans in hand-to-hand combat. So if you just get close enough to them, we've got the upper hand. That's what they thought. Colonel Yahara, remember he was the plans and operations officer, had a completely different notion about this. He thought this was just the worst thing they could possibly do. And to illustrate that, I wanted to read a quote. "We must continue the current operation, calmly recognizing its final destiny, for annihilation is inevitable no matter what is done." Their annihilation. He was committed to stay to the last man and die the last man, and maintain to a bitter end the principle of strategic holding action. "Moreover, our forces will inflict but small losses on the enemy, while on the other hand, scores of thousands of our troops will have been sacrificed in vain as victims of the offensive." There was quite a debate between the two men, Cho and Yahara. Cho and Yahara going back and forth. And finally, Cho basically just appealed to him and emotionally and almost cried during the time, trying to convince Yahara this is what they want to do. And Yahara conceded and went along with it, even though in his heart of hearts he knew it was the wrong thing to do. And Yusajima, though, approves the offensive. The offensive is on May 4th, and to no surprise, to Yahara at least, both the 77th and the 7th Division, which are on the left side of the American lines, holding the eastern part of the line, hold firm. But the Japanese now have exposed themselves. They've come out of these bunkers, they've come out of their caves, and so now they are susceptible to American warships, the 16 battalions of artillery that the Americans had on board, the 12 of the heavier artillery that the Corps had by that time, the 134 ground support aircraft joined in the fight, naval gunfire, and this assault force is decimated. Neither of those two amphibious forces did anything either. They all were sacrificed in the vain attempt as well. And in the midst of it, then, the 1st Marines went on counterattack, headed for Shuri itself. So in the process, the Japanese lose 6,227 dead. To the U.S. 7th and 77th lose 714. So no comparison whatsoever. Yahara was turned out to be absolutely right, and Yusajima says, "We're not going to do that again." They figured that out. Okay, then on May 7th, the inevitable happens and the rains come, and the battlefield is turned into mud. So if it wasn't miserable enough before that time, now it becomes even more miserable with the nature of the rain. The assault on the Naha Shuri line. This is the area that was most heavily defended. And so you've got, it's not hard to figure out why it's called the Naha Shuri line. Here's the major city in Okinawa, Naha. Shuri is where this castle was, the ancient capital of Okinawa. And then you've got, it's anchored on the eastern side on Yanaburo. I'm sure I'm butchering almost all of these terms here. Forgive me for that. And four U.S. divisions are now aligned in the attack. You've got the 6th Marine, and this is from west to east, the 6th Marine, the 1st Marine, the 77th Infantry, and the 96th Infantry, which had now been brought into the line again. Some of the toughest fighting of the campaign is being done, and as I've mentioned several times, this is fighting that's happening at squad, platoon, and maybe company level, and using these new tactics that the Americans had developed. The enemy is dug in, and oftentimes if you got to the front side of the slope and you're now fighting, you go across the crest and you're fighting on the back side, the reverse slope is what the military would say. The Japanese are coming out of those exits on the reverse side and blasting away. So it was dangerous business, however you coined it. To give you an idea of how dangerous it was, I wanted to read a quote from Robert Leckie, who describes this combat. On May 11th, the 1st began, 1st Marines, began bucking at a ridge in Dakashi's town. Both fell after a seesaw three-day battle, the Americans plodding forward by day, the Japanese counterattacking by night. Daylight sometimes met a fresh attack to recover ground surrendered during the night. Platoons took a position at the cost of three-fourths of their men, then tried to hang on with the survivors. Sometimes they could. In the town, the Marines found a labyrinth of tunnels, shafts, and caves with snipers everywhere among the ruins, crouching behind broken walls, hidden wells, or cisterns. And like we saw in Iwo Jima, because of the incredible bravery of the American troops, both Army and Marines, 23 Medal of Honor recipients during this campaign, 23. And here's another trait of Americans. They love to have colorful names for different objectives. And you can see a couple of them here. Let me see if I can find them. Sugarloaf Hill, Chocolate Drop Hill. There was a Strawberry Hill. All these colorful names that they came up with. And at night, when they're hunkered down, especially in the Navy, and they're listening on the ships, they might have an opportunity to listen to Tokyo Rose, except she called herself Orphan Annie. So here's the kind of thing they would hear from Orphan Annie. Excuse me, Orphan Anne.
Greetings, everybody. This is your number one enemy, Orphan Anne. We're ready again for 75 minutes of music and news for our friends, our enemy at Okinawa. Sugarloaf Hill, Chocolate Drop, Strawberry Hill. Gee, these places sound wonderful. You can just see the candy houses with the white picket fences around them and the candy canes hanging from the trees, their red and white stripes glistening in the sun. But the only thing red about these places is the blood of Americans. Yes, sir, these are the names of hills in southern Okinawa, where the fighting is so close that you can get down to bayonets and sometimes your bare fists. I guess it's natural to idealize the worst places with pretty names to make them seem less awful. Why, Sugarloaf has changed hands so often, it looks like Dante's Inferno. Yes, sir. Sugarloaf Hill, Chocolate Drop, Strawberry Hill. They sound good, don't they? Only those who've been there know what they are really like.
So why would the GIs and the Marines be listening to Tokyo Rose? Several women played the role of Tokyo Rose over the war. Why would they listen? They would discount all the propaganda she was talking about, but they sure enjoyed listening to the American pop music that she would be playing at the time. And that's why they were listening. I mentioned there was something like 500,000 civilians. Early before the campaign began, the Japanese tried to ship as many out as they possibly could. So there was considerably less than 500,000 when the campaign started. But they resented the treatment they got from the Japanese, but they feared the Americans because the Japanese had told them the Americans were terrorists, barbarians, would do horrible things if they were captured. You can't possibly trust them. It would be better to die rather than be captured by the Americans. Their conditions during the fight itself, and this is a quote from a Japanese doctor about the conditions they generally were facing. Wandering and lodging here and there in the mountain caves and riversides, crying and weeping, they are near death, overwhelmed with hideous fatigue. The numbers you get, it's almost impossible to tell, but something in the neighborhood of 42,000 to 122,000 Okinawan civilians died during this campaign. That itself is a staggering number, I think. A sizable number of those are combat related. A certain much smaller number actually committed suicide. There's some film of Okinawans running off a cliff into the ocean, killing themselves that way. And some were even killed by Japanese soldiers to prevent them to surrender or to steal food from the Okinawans itself. So that was the condition that the Okinawans were facing at the time. And we're now nearing the end of the battle itself. By the time you get to June, we've gotten all the way to the very southern tip of the island itself. You can see there on the 14th of June. June 12th, the remnants of the Japanese are trapped about 4 miles, the last 4 miles in the southern tip. On the 18th, General Buckner, is visiting a unit near the front lines, talking to the subordinate commanders, the general, and a couple other staff officers. And he had just made the comment to them, if I can find it here, "Things are going well here. I think I'll move on to another unit." Shortly after he moves on to the next unit, some enemy artillery comes in, and he was killed by shrapnel. A lieutenant general, the highest ranking officer in the Pacific, who's killed in enemy combat. June 21st, then, the Japanese are trapped at Hill 95, which is in this vicinity right here. And at that time, General Yoshijima decides it's time. He's given up. We're not going to be able to win. There's no way we can be victorious. He sends his last message to Japan. And here's the message. "Our strategy, tactics, and techniques all were used to the utmost. We fought valiantly, but it was nothing before the material strength of the enemy." So, comment was made to me before how important logistics is in combat. And as far as the Japanese was concerned, there is no way they can stand up to the weight of the American and the combined Allied forces that they brought to wreak havoc on Okinawa itself. One day later, the headquarters staff decides to make a last banzai charge. This is a better way, as far as they are concerned, a banzai charge, to commit suicide that way rather than to die in their bunkers. And General Yoshijima and Cho decide to commit seppuku. That's the ceremonial way to commit suicide if you're a samurai warrior. And it involves burying your gut area, taking your ceremonial sword, and disemboweling yourself. And that's what they did. And immediately after that, one of their staff officers took the sword and beheaded both of them, and probably burned their bodies so they would never be found again. Before that, I find this interesting as well. Yoshijima wanted to have somebody who would be able to tell the story of what actually happened in Okinawa. And that somebody turned out to be Colonel Yahara. So we're hearing the story about what happened with the Japanese from Yahara's own voice after the war itself. The casualties. The death toll is astounding. 77,000 plus U.S., that's close to 8,000 dead on the Army side, over 4,000 dead in the Navy, and you can see the rest of the numbers. For the Japanese, somewhere in the neighborhood of 100,000 to 110,000 dead. Look at the POWs. Now we begin to see a more willingness on the Japanese part to actually surrender, saying that the end is near. What is the use in doing this? It's still just a tiny percentage of the overall forces. But what's interesting to me also is that for the weeks and months after the end of campaigning in Okinawa, you begin to see a lot of these Japanese coming out of their caves and bunker positions and surrendering, many of them after the war had actually ended. And again, the number of civilian deaths. This is devastation on an unimaginable scale. And I think it has everything to do with what I wanted to conclude with here. The invasion of plans for Japan. That was going to start in November of 1945, with another Operation Coronet beginning a few months after that. Kyushu Island would be the first one. Three Marine divisions and 11 Army divisions eventually would be in Kyushu Island right here. And then later on in the early 1946, Operation Coronet, the 8th Army and 10th Army lands on Tokyo Plain, right in this area right here. Three Marine and 25 Army divisions. Many of those Army divisions being shipped over from Europe. The Pacific Fleet, the 20th Air Force, and of course by the time you get to July and August, early August, the Air Force was having a hard time even finding good targets to bomb with their strategic bombers. And Warren Mush is another individual I interviewed. Warren Mush was a Marine intelligence officer at the regimental level. He survived Iwo Jima. 70% of his regiment were casualties in Iwo Jima, but he survived, went back to Hawaii, and spends the next couple of months planning for the invasion of Japan. And that's what you're going to hear him talking about here.
An invasion on Kyushu was to be in November. Following March was to be an invasion of the homeland on Tokyo Plain. Okay, 14 divisions on Kyushu, 3 Marine and 11 Army. The Tokyo Plain, 28 divisions involved, 3 Marine and 25 Army. 3 million men involved in the operation, minimum, and at least 1 million casualties. On Iwo, your wounded were about 3 wounded, 1 killed. You know, with the more I knew about it, the more I felt that I would not survive if it came about. So that's why I say.
I'll cut off just a little bit. That's Truman's decision to use the atomic bomb, he's convinced saved his life. Who knows how many casualties the Americans would have suffered. But if the Japanese would have continued to resist like they did in Iwo Jima and Okinawa, and by that time they were training Japanese civilians to resist in any way they could possibly, it just looked to be a very grim equation. So the decision was made by Truman in July, once they knew they had a workable atomic bomb, to bomb Hiroshima on August 6th, to bomb Nagasaki on August 9th. There's the devastation of the center of Hiroshima. And it's August 14th that you have the Japanese surrender, only after the Emperor Hirohito insists that that's what they're going to do, over the resistance from many of the senior army officers who resisted to the very end of that decision. So, yesterday, September 2nd, 1945, then is the 75th anniversary of this event, the formal surrender ceremony on the USS Missouri in the Tokyo Harbor. And of course, the man you see sitting there at the desk is none other than General Douglas MacArthur. So that's the time now for some questions and comments, if you have any. And Joe, you already got one.
Yes, Mark Thomas checks in and asks, although it would have taken longer, would it have been possible to isolate the island, preventing any resupply, essentially laying siege to the island and starving them into submission?
It's part of the argument about whether or not to use the atomic bomb in the first place. It is an argument that rages on to this day. Most military strategists then and to this day think that it was going to be necessary to invade mainland Japan. And that's part of the equation. Could they have done that? Yes, they certainly could. But to be able to launch an invasion of mainland Japan, which they thought was absolutely necessary, given the experience they had in Iwo Jima and the resistance they had in Iwo Jima, you knew that the Japanese were totally dedicated to the point of exterminating the entire race, practically, to defend themselves and to die to the last Japanese. Now, was that actually likely to happen? We can speculate to the day has ended with those discussions. But to be able to invade mainland Japan, it was important to have Okinawa as a logistical base and a place to be able to fly aircraft as well. So I'm going to hedge just a little bit, but I think I will say this, that they had made the right decisions to invade Okinawa.
Francie checks in and wants to know if you have any comments on the 2020 publication, 82 Days on Okinawa, if you've had a chance to read it or know a little bit about it.
There's been all kinds of recent literature, and I've been reading stuff that was written quite a while ago, so I have not experienced that one. I can't answer that.
And we have a question from Bill. Let me bring that up here. Bill says, I understand that the airfields in Okinawa were never used by the U.S. Army Air Corps or Navy after the battle ended. Is that true? And if so, was the victory worth the cost?
I think the airstrips on Ishima were definitely used, and I would imagine the ones on Okinawa itself were as well. I can't answer definitively on that part, but I can't imagine why they would not. I mean, one of the very early things that would have happened after you land the major forces and start moving south is you start having the Seabees land as well and refurbish those airstrips.
And we have a comment here, not necessarily a question, but several different comments. A number of people have mentioned relatives or grandparents, whatnot, grandfathers that served. But Aaron says, my dad was a staff sergeant initially involved with inventorying supplies, but as the battle escalated, he and his unit were in charge of inventorying the American soldiers killed during battle. So I can imagine that was a grim duty, but a necessary one nonetheless.
And so many times, as you found in this case I was talking about, they never do find the bodies. They've just been lost. And most of the casualties, the dead that would have been initially buried on Okinawa would eventually have been moved to other cemeteries because, again, the American policy is you don't have cemeteries on terrain, on land that was the enemy's at the time of the war.
And Catherine DiNardo with a comment said that her grandfather was killed April 10th, was in the 7th Infantry Armory, also a private, and she commented that her mother has all of the letters he wrote to her grandmother as well as all the letters that were returned after his death. So another good example of preserving that family history.
And I would imagine our manuscripts department would be very happy to have those letters donated sometime in the future so that others can have the same experience and begin to appreciate the sacrifice that these young men made. Do we have any from the audience here? More on yours end, Joe.
It looks like we're good. So, Mark, ladies and gentlemen, for the friends and family that were here, to give Mark a little bit of an audience, let's give a round of applause for Dr. DePue. Another wonderful presentation. Mark, thank you so much, and I think the next time we'll see you on this stage or in one of our spaces will be coming up around Veterans Day in November. You and one of your volunteers, Mark Floto, are going to be working on a program examining some Civil War letters based on a book he published here in the last year.
And if I can, about 15 or 16 months from now, I've at least made the proposal to do something similar for Pearl Harbor, the 80th anniversary of Pearl Harbor.
I think that is definitely in order. So again, Mark, thank you very much. Thank you for watching tonight from the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum in Springfield, Illinois. Have a good evening.
Thank you.